So hi, hello everyone, good morning. Yeah, so I wish to share an interesting story which happened with me a few weeks back. So I was walking along the streets of Kormangla, just pub hopping. It was some late hours on the weekend when I got a call from my manager. So it was very abnormal and it was very an odd hour for getting a call, and it was quite unusual. So reluctantly I picked up the call. So my manager on the other side is like, Akash, looks like something's wrong. One Indian girl is all over recommendations. Now, being a bachelor, I was curious like who this girl is. So anyway, I asked him for more details, like what girl are you talking about? And he replied back that there is this new release by Chetan Bhagat, One Indian Girl, which is like all over recommendation widgets on our website. So yeah, so that was one of the things. So I immediately rushed back home and like booted up my laptop, went on to browsing. So yeah, so I picked up this book, GRE for Dummies, and yeah, as well, my manager was saying, this One Indian Girl started like was surfacing somewhere in the middle, like looking out of place. Yeah, then I went to this book by Shashi Tharoor again. Again, One Indian Girl was here as well. So I was like very confused and like what went wrong, and I started debugging. But then it struck me that, okay, there was this campaign, marketing campaign, which Flipkart had launched, which was selling this book for, say, 1 rupee when bought along with other books. So yeah, so probably that was the one of the reasons why like this was appearing all over where it shouldn't have. So clearly this was an example of our ranking gone wrong. So in this talk, we will look at some of the like relevance and ranking aspects, how we do relevance, how we do ranking, what might have potentially caused such a blatant, such an error. And yeah, so before that, let me first tell you what recommendations are. So say you go to an offline salesman, right? You go to an IKEA showroom and you ask the salesman for a say a running shoes of certain size. You specify your need in terms of a certain maybe price, maybe a certain type of color, maybe a purpose, say running shoes, right? And he comes back to you with a bunch of suggestions. So he not just uses your direct query, instead he applies the context as well. So he checks what season is it. Is it a like winters or summers, or is it like raining? So that will help him prune down. Also, he might look at the build of your body, the shoe size, for getting back to you some suggestions. So in the online world, this widget is solving that in some respect. So in the online world, we have some context of the user, maybe previous purchases, or it could be the browsing history of the user. And on top of that, we know that their user has landed on Puma shoes, and we want to recommend a set of similar products, right? So here again, there are these size and color variations that we offer, and different suggestions based on a bunch of criteria. So some of those criteria we'll cover as a part of today's talk. Yeah. So okay. So I'm going to structure my talk like this. So first, I'll cover about the relevance bits. So what is relevance, different techniques towards relevance. You have content-based and collaborative techniques. Then I'll go into the ranking, how we can rank products optimally given the context. How do we create an architecture which allows us for quick experimentation? What features do we use for ranking? And finally, I wish to leave some time for Q&A. Yeah, so let's first right jump into what relevance is. So given a context, right? In the previous slide, the context was the shoe in question. So is the suggestion relevant? So we want to ask such a Boolean question to the recommender system, right? So the question is, does the candidate which we are recommending cross the certain relevancy threshold? So how do we define such a threshold? Here is a graph showing a precision requirement versus the context requirement. So something like homepage of Flipkart, right? User has not typed in any query, he just visited Flipkart. So the nature of context is quite implicit. We might have some history, but he has not explicitly said what he is looking for. On the other extreme, we have a very explicit context of a search page. So search page, users typed an actual search query, and in that case, we have to live with a very high precision. So we can't deviate much from the search term. So if the query was say Nike sport shoes, we have to be within the limits. We can't deviate much from the required suggestions. The product page is somewhere in middle. So product page is the details page which we saw. It's somewhere in the middle. So nature of context is moderate, where we are not as lenient as homepage and as strict as search page. So the precision requirement will be also moderate, and that will help us decide what threshold of precision do you want to play in. So there are a bunch of techniques majorly divided into content and collaborative techniques, which helps us figure out the relevance. So obviously I don't want to recommend a shoe for something like a mobile. That is totally irrelevant. But within shoes, how do you define relevance? So let's get into collaborative aspect, right? So first let me tell you what collaborative filtering is. So say on the left side you see a category hierarchy. So this can be any commerce hierarchy that we might have. So for example, you can start with a footwear or footwear on the top. Below footwear you could have shoes, sandals. Within shoes you could have casual shoes, formal shoes. So it's basically a taxonomy that you helps user in the browsing of the thing, browsing across Flipkart. Then we have user activity. So user, when he came to Flipkart, you could have the user browsing through the website. Then you can add to cart, add to wish list, or perform some other activity, finally leading to a purchase. So all that will be coming under the umbrella of user activity. So once we have this category hierarchy and the user activity, we want to perform this collaborative filtering to give a set of relevant suggestions, right? So let's see what is inside this block of collaborative filtering, right? Yeah. So here you see three books which are there. There is an introduction to algorithms, there's computer networks, and there is 5.someone, right? So the Venn diagrams here represent proxy to the volume of these visits to these. And the Venn diagram overlap will represent an extent of overlap. So it's quite intuitive that more the extent of overlap, more related those suggestions are. For example, like for algorithms, networks might be nearer than say 5.someone. However, there's one nuance to it. So that nuance being the popular products might end up coming in most of the suggestions. So something like 5.someone, which is like top seller, will creep into all academic books, fiction books, non-fiction books, almost everywhere on the website. So we have to discount the overlap by the popularity of the product. So cosine similarity is one such measure which is used wisely, where intersection count is kept on the is normalized by the popularity of the individual products, right? So cosine, the extent, will give you an extent of overlap and will tell you whether these two suggestions are limited related or not. So here we saw that there are these three individual products where we mined some kind of patterns. So we said that algorithms is nearer to computer networks rather than 5.someone. It need not be at individual product level. So take this example for the case of saris. So this slide might not be fully visible, but let me read it out aloud. So you have this, in the center you have a fabric type of a sari called synthetic georgette. Right, so there are around 150 or 200 fabric types of saris we sell, which basically help user prune down the decision. But it, now, if you see synthetic georgette, using collaborative filtering and user basically user activity data, we can mine these things like pure georgette is somehow related to synthetic georgette. So is art silk. So is chiffon. So this attribute, this gives us kind of an attribute graph which we can work on top of, and basically, that extends our product-to-product similarity that we saw in the last slide. So this example which you saw is constrained to a single category. So we had sari as a category, and within sari, we were able to recommend few attributes. So, but there is no reason just to be restricted to a category. For example, during the recently concluded like World Cup, one of the patterns that we saw was this theme, Ronaldo surfacing, cross diverse kind of recommendation. For example, this decal, laptop decal, is from the electronic accessories category. So if we do a category cut, we won't be able to surface such a pattern. But since the user activity can be across categories, it can be very broad. We got such patterns. So there, these wallets and t-shirts, which were from the fashion category, were showing somewhere down the electronics category. So if we apply some rules, like fashion should be shown only within the context of fashion, we will miss out on such patterns. And hence, it might be important to balance out the category mix with such kind of patterns, which are coming directly from user activity. Right. So till now, we saw how user activity can be used towards mining patterns. Another important aspect to derive recommendations might be using the product attributes. So here we start with some product attributes. We apply some kind of attribute similarity, and we get a set of relevant products. So what, like, let's get into what attribute similarity is, right? So there are two TVs here. There is a VU TV. There is a Kodak TV. They have some bunch of attributes which are defined. Some are visible here, like there is price, there is offers, there is some kind of warranty, there is a screen size here. Some are not visible to the users. So I listed down some of these attributes. So there is screen size, brand, whether it's a 3D or not, HDMI cable, all those things. So some of those attributes will match and some will. So more the attributes matching, more similar those two products will be. Now there are certain things with respect to attributes. Those attributes might not be complete. So those are the nuances we have to deal with. What do we do with, for case of incomplete attributes? Also, all these attributes are not equal in the sense. So like, let me take a quick show of hands. So we have these screen size brands. So how many of you think screen size is more important for making a purchase decision of a TV? Okay. And how many think brand is more important? Yeah, I see a very divided audience. So yeah, we don't rely on this intuition to do this judgment. One of the ways to derive what is the relative importance of these things is looking at the data itself. So we have these filters which are present on for screen size, brand, for any TV kind of query, right? So number of people clicking screen size is a good proxy of the importance of screen size. Similarly, number of people who are clicking on the brand filter will tell us that, oh, brand is more important than screen size. So that is one kind of way where data can be used to power the important relative importance of these features. Another important thing which is the search queries itself. So if people are typing more of 42-inch TVs kind of queries, then 42-inch is a more important criteria in the minds of the user while making a TV purchase. Yeah, so here we saw the catalog structured attributes. Another thing which can be used is the image itself. So image of the product, say we start from the image of the product, we apply some kind of visual similarity techniques, and again, you can get a set of visually similar recommendations. Yeah, so here we have a sari. We want to, our objective is to show visually similar saris to the this sari. So it can span across brands, different price ranges, but we want it to be close in the sense of looking wise. So we train a neural network for identifying some such queries. So we give that a query image, a positive and a negative image. So the objective is of this is to bring the query and the positive image as close to each other as possible and the negative image farther apart. So basically this neural network will try to learn a lower dimensional representation. So starting from the raw pixels, it will try to learn a representation of each of these images such that say this query and the positive image will be closer in that lower dimensional space rather than the negatives will be farther apart. And then we can do for this sari search for the nearest neighbors in that space to find the some proxy to the similarity. So one other observation that we had while dealing with such data was since we are a marketplace, there are a bunch of sellers which sell similar kind of products. And when we first put this out model out into production, what had happened was we had almost near duplicates coming up. So in fact, like exact same saris started surfacing in the recommendations, which was given as a feedback back to the catalog that these are near duplicates. These need not be different items. So these can be clubbed into a single item with say multiple sellers, and then that could lead to a better customer experience, like rather than showing the exact same item again and again, right? So till now we saw like how user activity and product attributes can be used to compute some similarity metric between a pair of products, right? Initially what we had is we had different widgets for these. So we had something like customers who bought this also bought based on say collaborative filtering. We had attribute similarity, a module for attribute like matching attributes, a module for visual similarity. So these we could afford to have different modules. But recently we saw an interesting trend like with Jio and all coming up. The mobile traffic started exceeding. So at this point, like majority of our traffic comes from mobile. So it may be mobile website or Android. And we might not have space for like separate widgets of visual, separate widgets for collaborative and this. So for the user, we might want to combine these two widgets. So like how do we get into combining them? So like we had these relevance criteria, we had collaborative filter, attribute and visual similarity. How do we combine them into a single ranked suggestion list, right? So let's see what we have at our disposal. So we have first, we have the user clicks. So we showed a bunch of these things to the user. We got some click feedback. So if the user is clicking more and more, it tells us about engagement. So you have some module might lead to more engagement than the other. So that could be one of the criteria to judge which of these is performing better in terms of user clicks, right? One problem with clicks, which we saw at the start of the presentation, which was like this 1 rupee book was leading to a lot of clicks, and that led to that Chetan Bhagat book, probably led to that Chetan Bhagat book surfacing all over the place because people are browsing it a lot out of curiosity, but probably not purchasing it. So another important thing that comes into picture is why don't you take conversion itself? So not the engagement, but the conversion. So it's important to specify what you want to rank for. So you will combine these, but how to combine will matter, will be dependent on like what do you want to optimize for conversion or you want to optimize for user engagement. So typical goals of a recommendation system. So there's a trade-off between engagement versus conversion. Also important are these diversity and serendipitous elements. So user expect the recommendation engine to show some surprising content. One of the examples which we saw was this Ronaldo-based patterns where people might be browsing, they might be fans of Ronaldo, which might be browsing products across categories with a unifying theme, right? So what we use the learning to rank for combining these different relevant signals. So it's a machine learned model to generate the rank list. So what it does basically, we have a set of items to recommend. Those might be obtained from any of the categories. So any of the category of relevance. So you have collaborative content-based techniques, which will give that thing. And we have product conversion data. So like positives will be much lesser because out of a lot of people that come to Flipkart, many don't end up purchasing. So a fraction of the people will be purchasing and that will be positives and there will be a lot of negatives in the product conversion data. So we train our model to we pass those items to the model and which will help us score each of those models. Right. So what we are doing in essence, right? We are taking those clicks and purchase signals and passing a feedback loop back to the ranking block. So let's see what this feedback looks like at Flipkart. Right. So we started with a linear logistic regression based model. One important thing was to ensure the production sanity. Right. So once we deployed this model. There were a lot of gaps in the incoming data. So we are relying on a lot of data that is coming in. There is a click data, conversion data, and there's relevant signals. Some of them might get delayed or some of them might not be up to date. So that sanity, so how do we measure the performance of such a model becomes an important consideration. So the scale at which we work, like these are rough numbers. So like out of like 100 million odd products we have, recommendations of so we are confidently able to recommend a subset of them. So around 15 to 20% of products is where we'll be confidently able to say, okay, these are the relevant products, rank among them. The training points which we saw, the conversion, we take 1 month back, 1 month window of data. So the conversions of which happened in the last month from the recommendation widgets around order of a billion training points. And then we have the scoring, which is the pairs being scored, right? So for a pair, we'll have different scores. So we'll have a score from the collaborative filtering engine. We'll have a score from the attribute attribute matching engine. We'll have another score from the visual similarity engine. And they will come together to be scored by this ranking module, right? So one thing about this thing which we experienced during Big Billion Days, right? So we got a lot of traffic, and our model started behaving quite abnormally during this Big Billion Days. So we were like curious, like why is this happening, right? So apparently what we realized is the traffic that comes during Big Billion Days is a very different kind of traffic. They are looking for probably some deals, and the way we are optimizing for conversion, we were not taking these deals as a factor in our recommendations. So like we initially started, we treated this data as anomaly. So whenever there was a spike sale on our platform, we just ignored that data. Another way to deal with this could be to adjust the training data with sale day as a feature. So for example, you could have these, there are certain days in the calendar which are marked for us, like they might be Diwali sales or New Year sales. You could take them as a feature and rank specifically for the sale kind of scenarios. Yeah. So till now we saw how these relevance signals helped us rank the overall set of products, right? So let's see what other features can be useful to us. So one of the features which are important in this respect are the quality features. So what I mean by quality, so every product on Flipkart we sell has a notion of quality. So it, even in the minds of the user, in the minds of whoever is purchasing, there is a ratings data that we have, right? So people rate all the products. Then there might be people who are writing some reviews. So reviews are very useful in the respect that they can help us mine some information. Is it a positive review? Is it a negative review? Positive review tell us that, okay, people like this product, so it's a good quality product. So the hypothesis here is the quality, more the higher the quality, the higher will be the conversion. Right. So let's see. So we started with this human labeled data. So there was a category team which supplied us with a set of good products. Initially, it performed quite well, but as we moved to more and more, as the data became stale, right? So the category managers can't tag. So they initially say gave a set of 1 lakh to 1 to 2 lakh FSNs products, which were human labeled, saying that these are good products. But these products are very hard to refresh. It's a so we moved to the crowdsourced version, which is the ratings, reviews, and the return rate. So return rate is one another aspect. If a product is getting returned a lot, that seller or that product class of product might not be suitable for the because people are returning it a lot. It's a huge cost on the marketplace. Yeah. So these quality features have a sparsity problem because we are explicitly asking the user to mark a rating. So very few of our products, a small fraction of our products, have ratings and reviews. In that case, it's useful to fall back to the next higher level of aggregation. So we saw the category hierarchy, which can be used here as well. So category hierarchy can feed into the model, and just we can average it by seller, or we can average it by brand. So there is a poor brand. For example, relatively speaking, right, Bose will have a much lower return rate than say something like Skullcandy. So we can basically penalize the entire brand. Say there is a new Skullcandy earphone versus when we are comparing with a Bose earphone, probably people like Bose kind of earphones more, and they will have a higher quality. And quality will naturally have an impact on the conversion which we are trying to predict. Another set of features that we found in useful was the historical features. So like all of us here are attending Fifth Elephant. It's a very good example of historical features. So all of you might have seen those feedback forms floating around. So like, do you know why those feedback forms are useful? So like what Fifth Elephant uses those forms is, it gets the speaker's feedback and uses that feedback for the next edition of Fifth Elephant. So there's a feedback loop built right into here. Similarly, in the e-commerce space, these historical products, historical features will be helpful to us, right? So one thing about historical features, so they get stale very fast. So there are these new product editions, prices will change, offers will change, and hence we need to refresh these things very, very quickly. boost in our when we did a new update, index update, right? So that's why historical features are like very powerful. So historical feature will be something like, say there is a brand, HP brand, and products from those HP brands are performing very good. In contrast to Acer, something like Acer brand will not perform very good. So we might want to take that factor, historically speaking, if there are a good performing products, rank it above the lower performance products. So one other interesting nuance was about presentation, right? So we have different presentation channels. So we have this desktop website, we have Android, and the nature of the interface makes it very different. So there are devices of different sizes that are available in the Android market. So all these presentation aspects matter a lot while making a prediction, the ranking prediction, right? So on the left, you see a screenshot of Android, which is a 2x2 grid. So your entire focus is on the Android widget. Here, this is a screenshot from the desktop website where you have a one widget, but in the overall scheme of the page, this is just one of the rows. So users' focus might be on multiple places in the desktop website, right? So what do you call an impression? So impression is basically when the user is seeing your module. So impressions are quite useful to measure the performance of the widget, right? So in case of Android, all of those four are most likely to be seen by the user. On the other hand, these six for the desktop setting might not have been seen by the user because user attention might be divided. So we need to factor in all those scenarios while accounting for the performance. So say Android, it will naturally get more clicks because of this behavior. So Android tends to get a much higher clicks because your entire attention is on your device. On desktop, we get very less clicks in that comparison. So we have to normalize those impressions by the channel. One other interesting thing which we found was the usage of the thumb on Android, right? So you are scrolling on the Android device, and most of us are right-handers, like majority of us. So people tend to click the right-sided positions much more, right? So the odd positions are clicked much lesser than the even positions. This is one of the findings that we had from when we analyzed the position data for Android. For desktop, we have a mouse click. There is no such behavior which is observed on the desktop setting, right? So now how do we treat that becomes an important question. Like, do we initially our thinking is we'll deploy one model in production which will work for all channels, but is that really true? Because users are looking for very different, users are behaving very, very differently in these channels. So do we deploy two different models for different channels, or do we take in channel is just a feature in one our computation, right? So all those trade-offs have to be taken into account while doing this presentation trade-offs. So overall, right, let's see what all we covered till now. So we started from a bunch of input signals. So we had category hierarchy, user activity data, these attributes and images. We applied a bunch of relevance techniques. Also fed in these features, the quality, historical, and presentation features to a ranking module. Optimized it basis the clicks or conversion, right? So these clicks or conversion is what we used as an optimization, and gave us a final picture of the ranking block. So these things were developed over an iteration, multiple iterations. So we started initially with few of those blocks. Some took multi-month effort, some took like years of effort to build. So I tried to like color code this into this slide. So the darker represents like more amount of time, up to like years of effort. The lighter was something we were able to achieve relatively faster. So historical features, although they look very simple, to get them right and to analyze them at the right granularity of category is quite important. Yeah, so this pipeline, right? So there are these bunch of pipelines running here. So there is a user activity to collaborative filtering pipeline, attribute similarity pipeline, visual similarity pipeline. So most of these are scheduled once a day in our case. So each of those gets refreshed once a day. And those features are prepared from the user activity data itself. So historical history is again prepared from the previous data of the user. There is presentation which is prepared from the feedback which is coming from those Android and desktop channels. Quality are prepared again from ratings and review data sets, right? So those get refreshed daily, and altogether this training and scoring also happens once in a day. So we have these jobs scheduled, which basically start from the raw data sources and compute, and every day a new index gets pushed to production for our scenario. Yeah, so that's it. These are the references that I have used in this presentation, and yeah, I'll be happy to take some questions.
Hello. Yeah. Off the charts demand, guys. Can we have the people sitting on the stairs move to one side so that the mic runners can run? Yeah. Let's start.
My question is to just studying the behavioral pattern of a customer. Based on the clickstream data, that is real-time analytics. Suppose the customer is new and he is clicking on your products, and after that, that is a real-time analytics. He may buy or do not buy. Suppose he buy, he chooses some product in the COD. What are the probability or the chances that the customer should return the product or not return the product? And in case, what is the success failure rate of Flipkart? And even the customer do not buy, what is the how is the classification done?
Okay, so you asked about what is the usual success rates, right? So I can't actually disclose the actual raw numbers.
Behavioral pattern of a customer on based on the clickstream data,
right? So here we had so on the right you had clicks and conversion data, right? So the previous data is analyzed here. So what we try to do is the last 30 days of data is what is fed back into the model, right? So we already have the conversion rates of the user, we already have the click rate. So say there is some module which has 10% click rate, right? So 10% will be treated as positives and other 90% will be negatives.
No, I'm not talking about historical data.
Yeah.
I'm talking about real-time analytics.
Suppose so in this case, what we are doing is we are limiting ourselves to historical itself. We are just taking the previous few days of windows, which is sufficient for us to make a recommendation because the patterns don't change that much in within a day. So what we have figured out is the cost of doing real-time is much it's much more than cost of doing batch. So in our case, batch was the right fit. So we relied only on the historical like.
And how the classification is done when the customer does not buy the product?
Yeah, in that case, it's treated as a negative sample. So if you buy, it's a positive sample. If you don't buy, it's a negative. So that's how you try to divide your data.
Hello, thank you for your speech. It was a great one. So I have two questions primarily. So first one is, since Flipkart would have large amount of data, how do you schedule your jobs? Because collaborative filtering takes so much time, probably assuming hours for your case. And second question is, have you ever tried supervised machine learning techniques for classification such as XGBoost or any other technique?
So first, how do we schedule our jobs, right? So it depends on the data. So downstream jobs depend on the availability of the data upstream, right? So as soon as there is a refresh, say ratings data is refreshed, right? So there will be a triggered job which will trigger, as soon as the ratings, it will notify the next job that, okay, we are ready to process because we have the latest rating data available. Similarly, this feedback data is collected. So as soon as the feedback data preparation will complete, it will feed into the scoring block, right? And for attribute similarity, it's just a batch job which runs. So collaborative filtering, yes, it does take a few hours. So we try to run it in a distributed fashion over a distributed Hadoop cluster. So yeah, so these jobs are chained to each other. So first job output will be chained to give output to the second block and so on, right? And the second question, yeah, we haven't tried XGBoost and all other those techniques. We kept ourselves to a simple model, which was partly interpretable as well. So which helped us debugging all these case studies and use cases I talked about, like because we relied on very, very simple model, which were quite explainable, and we could actually debug the weightage of each of the constituent features.
Akash, good job, nicely presented as well. A very simple question. Do you have an alert mechanism over here to identify whether the model is failing?
Yeah, yeah.
And if so, what
it's
does
very
it
important
like?
To. So in our case, this model. So there are alerts at each stages, right? So there are two kind of alerts that we have. One is the volume based. So there should not be a sudden volume dip in any of these data sources. So if you are computing collaborative signals, it's based on user activity aggregates, right? So it can easily deviate across time to time. Example, in Big Billion Days, there could be a huge volume coming in. So we have those anomaly detectors for volume, right? Then model, how do you measure it? So this is a ranking model. One of the metrics we use is AUC, right? So area under the curve, we regularly monitor. So there are two kind of, so one is the train test area under the curve, right? So you measure this during the offline modeling and scoring pipeline, right? There is an online component to it as well. So say you have say an AUC of 75 during your offline deployment, right? Does it translate to online scenario? So when the users actually came the next day, were you able to predict the ranking? How many times were you able to predict the ranking in the online scenario? Will tell us the contrast, right? So these AUC, we have alerts over, in, even if it dips by a single point, we have alerts on the AUC and we look back at the model, what weight it has learned. Has any anomalous data crept in? So those channel specific nuances I was talking about, they were derived from this only. So we had to segment our data by channel to get a complete picture.
So I just wanted to know how do you all go for deploying your model, because there would be large number of requests coming in real time, and the model has to serve those requests. Of course, caching cannot be one of the great solution because it would be different result for different user, right? So like that, how do you all scale up the model for serving the request?
Yeah, so there are two kind of models here. The one I talked about was a product pivoted model. So product to product preferences don't vary per request. So they can be cached, right? So product to product, you once you rank it entire day, unless the offers are changing, unless the price is changing a lot, those don't deviate. So these similarities between a pair of products don't change that much. For user side of models, we have a distributed service. So so still there could be those heavy users which are coming in, they might be served from cache, but there is a tail of users for which we actually make the model call, and that does happen in real time. So we have a hosted distributed service, which is a centralized service, which will help us do the prediction in runtime. So usually those we keep try to keep it very lightweight so that that can be done within the desired latencies.
Sir, please connect with me offline. There are other people.
Hey, so when you give this Zari example, so you are going into the feature space and just see how much differences there are, right?
So can you repeat?
Okay, so when you give the Sari example,
yeah.
So you were going to the feature space, you see that how much are they related and how far they are, right?
Yeah.
This, are you taking which feature to take into account? Let's say not Sari, a sunglass, a guy wearing sunglass here.
So you are talking about this, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So let's say a guy wearing sunglass. Okay. So a fair guy and a dark guy, those features you should not take when you are comparing sunglasses. So how you actually filter out which feature to take when I am taking in the feature space and doing that comparison over products?
Yeah, so there are like two answers to that. So there was a traditional, there was a earlier time when these used to be handcrafted features, right? So what feature do you give importance to? So there was this object detection block where you would detect that, okay, what is the foreground, what is the background, right? And then you will say, I'll give more focus to the foreground. In our case, all that is not essential. So if you see this query positive and negative, right? So what happens here is, if you supply it enough, so you supply it enough examples saying that the query is a, say a white guy wearing sunglasses and the positive is a black guy wearing sunglasses, right? So it starts to focus on the sunglasses itself, right? It knows where to focus on. So once you give this neural net enough examples of this kind, it will help you learn these kind of patterns, right? So you don't need to explicitly hard code any of these features in the model, right? Right. So in our case, we had this catalog was quite clean. So we didn't have such a composite image. When we worked with a real world setting, that is much more harder problem. So for our case, like this was a very simple setting where, see, this catalog, it's only a sari. There is no shoe in focus here, right? So similarly for sunglass, it will be only focused on the sunglass. So we had a luxury of having that clean data set already. Otherwise, you need much more pre-processing.
Do people have more questions? Okay, so clearly this is a pretty awesome talk because we have more questions than we did before. So before we let you have the questions, our next speaker is Uma, who's going to be talking after the chai break. I'd like to ask her to plug why you all should come back here for her talk.
Hi all, my name is Uma. I currently work at LinkedIn, but as part of my PhD thesis, I worked on something called as entity search, whose aim is to really upgrade your search experience. So all of you do use web search engines in for our day-to-day work, right? So I'm trying to I will try to give you an awareness of this way in which entity search hopes to upgrade your search experience. And if you're a search practitioner, I hope that you can take back some of the insights to, you know, improve your search engines. So hoping to see you at my talk. Thank you.
Thanks, Uma. So, Akash, do you want to go forward with the questions?
Yeah,
so
we're going
to
take
people who want to go for the chai break can go, but people who want to stick around are welcome to. Yeah. Also, I just want to ask. I know asking questions, it takes a bit of going outside of your comfort zone. Definitely does for me. So, in case if you're feeling not too comfortable taking the mic and asking a question, feel free to put it on Twitter and I'll try to read it out here on behalf of you. So in case you don't want to stand up and ask a question, which is completely cool. So feel free to put it on Twitter and we'll read it out for you here.
Thank you for the talk. You mentioned that across channels, you need to sometimes identify whether to use the channel as a feature or a different model entirely. You mentioned the right hand thumb rule case as well. So what are the factors that you usually consider apart from the cost benefit analysis, let's just say the technical analysis that you conduct to use that the channel as a feature or a different model entirely?
Yes. So like you said, the first answer is cost benefit analysis. So running two parallel models and ensuring even to run the single model, it takes a lot of effort. So it was almost an year it took to reach to this state just for the ranking model itself. So maintaining two models is quite hard. So I'll always go with having a simplistic model. But in our case, we started with a linear model. So we might want to have the crossing kind of features, right? So the presentation features cross with the channel could give us then equal substitute of instead of having a separate model. So if you're able to, what we can do is we can prototype what performance these two individual models are giving. Is it far better than keeping a single model or a single more layer model with a multi-layered model with some kind of crossing? Then that is the trade-off basically. So crossing is one of the answers which even we are evaluating.
Thank you.
Okay, quick question. I don't see users' buying behavior being modeled here. Every user probably has a different buying behavior. And it also varies based on, when you received your salary or whatnot.
Absolutely. Yeah. So in the scope of this work, this is, like you correctly pointed out, this is product pivoted, right? So most of these things are happening product to product relevance, which has to be overlaid with a user-centric model. So we have a very a different model which deploys on which uses this as a background. So this forms a backbone kind of our recommender system, and then we have user signals overlaying. So one of the things which you said, user receiving salary in the start of the month, so should we recommend more expensive products to the start with, or should we recommend more value products at the end of the month? Absolutely. So that model sits on top of this model. So we have user to product and user to. So we saw the category hierarchy, right? So we have user to attribute as well, right? So what attributes you like, and within those attributes, what selection will you go for is a second level of detail, which can be overlaid these over these two. So in our case, we have kept this user to product and product to product quite separate, so that they are more interpretable, and we didn't combine the user to product prediction in the direct manner that way. There are alternate ways where you do a factorization and compute a single embedding for user and product, single like in the combined space. But in our case, we prefer to keep it separate.
Thanks for the informative talk. So my question is very specific on collaborative filtering. So it suffers with this cold start problem. Yes. Now there could be some products which are newly added to your catalog, which you might show up in your ranking for some reason. So how would you deal with that?
Yeah. So here we saw that there is a feedback loop that is comes in handy for that, right? So say we started showing, so we have a lot of selection. For some selection, we started showing those newly added products, right? Due to the feedback loop, it will get penalized, right? So what we do is we have this click and conversion data. Nobody will click on the new selection. Next day, so this thing is daily refreshed. So at most during the day, it will get highlights. And next day, it will automatically penalize the content, which is poor in performance. So that feedback loop comes in very handy. Okay, so what you are saying is basically how do you make new product surface at all, right? So yeah, there are various techniques which are available for that. So one of the techniques is called explore exploit, right? So what we are doing here is we are exploiting in the approach described. We are just saying that whatever is in the top of the list, show that. So usually the practice is to leave some kind of bucket, right? Say 20% for exploration. So for the exploration, you just randomly choose some of your selection. From the tail, say beyond the top 100 list, you randomly start showing that for the 20% users. Now again, due to the feedback loop, if that starts performing, it will start surfacing up. So explore exploit is one of the techniques which is used to bring that newer selection. That is a problem because we have a long tail of products which have no activity. So this is an ongoing problem we keep on attacking, right? So like explore exploit is one of the techniques we found useful for that.
Thanks, Akash. My question actually goes back to that same thing we have talked about 2-3 times even in the questions. So you have user to product mapping and product to product mapping, and product to product mapping is what you're caching for faster service. And that makes sense. The question is the user to product mapping lost in all of this process when you come to the final recommendation? I'll just give an example. So for example, I like hiking. And I browse a lot of hiking products. You like fashion, you browse a lot of fashion products. Both of us as users go to search for electronic cameras. Is the recommendation system more likely to show me a GoPro and show you a DSLR? Does that come into play? Is the user feature retained or is it lost over this whole process?
Yeah. So yeah, that's a good question. So we, if you deal with products, it will get lost. Like you rightly pointed out, if you deal with product and product to product, that theme will get lost. But here we saw something regarding latent behaviors, right? This one. So if you can capture latent concepts somehow, right? So travel as a theme, hiking as a theme. So these are not dedicated categories on Flipkart, right? These are some kind of themes which unite. So this is a football or Ronald, CR7 kind of theme, right, which unites them. So if you can identify such themes which are running across, so one of the ways to do that is factorization, which I was mentioning, where you represent them into, say, a 20 or 30 dimensional, a lower dimensional space, each of these products. And when you compress that into that space, probably you are likely to find such kind of patterns more. So that is a trade-off between, but then there is a problem with interpretability. So in that case, you might get some patterns which are like, which you might not be able to understand. Model is saying it's correct, but you might not be able to understand, and hence, there could be false positives as well. So we have to be careful of that.
Yeah, hey, thanks for the talk. So I just wanted to ask that you talked about a model to basically rank the products, okay? So now from whatever you spoke about, we have a lot of product level data, as in you have the image mapping data, you have the collaborative filter data, but basically what does it rank on? Taking all that data, so if it's a supervised learning, what does it rank on? What is that? Why?
Yeah, so on the right, you see there were two metrics which we covered. So one is customer engagement, which is like how is the user clicking a lot? Okay. And another one is conversion. Did this recommendation widget lead to a conversion? So it's very important to specify which do you want to optimize for. So at the start of the process, what we start with is whenever we are building the block, we have to first identify the criteria like you are mentioning. So you basically, it's your product managers along with you who will help you decide, okay, I want to optimize for clicks. I don't care about people purchasing, or I care about people purchasing. I don't want them to stick on my site that much, or it could be a balance.
Okay.
Right. So that balance will help us choose that trade-off. As data scientists, you are equal partners. So yes, you have a say. So in our case, we combined, it's a combined process. So yeah, so along with product, business, and DS.
Sir, follow-ups offline, please. There are other people waiting.
Thank you, Akash. My question is actually related to your team structure. Okay. So one, have you ever considered, I could gather it has taken you a long time to build this entire recommendation system.
Yeah.
Have you ever considered build versus buy decision, and what led you to build decision? Secondly, how is your team structured to ensure sustenance of this model on an ongoing basis?
Maybe one question and the second one you can take offline. Yeah,
yeah.
That's a lot of people.
Yeah, so to answer the first question, build versus buy. At Flipkart, most of the things we do rely on open source components, but most of the things are inbuilt because when you buy things, right, there is a big loop involved. So any corrections, so like you saw the nuances, right, those are very hard to capture in an external like outsourced scenario. So that position scenario, when you are sitting close with, so for example, for those we had to sit with Android team to understand. Like, is it really true your clicks happening on the right side, on desktop, where is your click, what is an impression? So all those are best done sitting with the, so even for the outsource setting, it's very recommended that those teams sit with you and do a combined effort rather than just focusing on the model part instead of looking at the data, seeing the distribution of the feature. So for our case, we have mostly preferred with building simpler stuff rather than off the shelf. We have not tried much into using the pre-built full solutions because they like won't be understanding such.
Hi Akash. Yes. So based on this recommender system, once the conversion has taken place, right? Mm-hmm. How does the recommendation completely change? So let's say I've been looking for a mobile and suddenly one day I buy the mobile. Next time I log into Flipkart, what really happens behind the picture? Because it keeps showing me the lot of mobiles.
Yeah. So there are multiple things in picture here. So one is you said that once you, so this is talking about product to product world, right? You are talking about the user world, which overlays on top of it. Yeah. So there are a lot of reasons why, like you are saying, right? Mobile can be resurfaced. So like here, I said that optimization is on click and conversion. There could be an incentive for us to, so people, for example, don't purchase their own mobiles for themselves. We have seen that actual people purchase mobile and then again after a week they'll purchase two more mobiles. So maybe they are purchasing it for their family. So along with clicks and conversion, there might be business consideration as well, which might lead to that. Also, there could be delays. So there was this pipeline, right? The entire pipeline. There could be delays in the data which is coming in. So all that is happening in batch, right? So there could be delays leading to that. Another thing which we were like discussing before the talk, could happen is mobiles might be placed under some, like, say, tablets category. So that miscategorization does happen. And in that case, we are actually recommending tablets and not mobiles. As a system wise, so all those kind of scenarios might lead to this abnormal kind of suggestions. But okay. Yeah, there might be a case to actually show such a suggestion because finally users are purchasing it again. So there are those categories which do a repurchase. I'll close
it. Thanks, Akash.